In recent years, CSS has seen significant advancements, becoming more powerful and flexible than ever. In this video, I'll share the top 5 CSS properties I use in almost every project. While these properties might seem basic, they significantly enhance the CSS workflow, making it smoother and more enjoyable. Welcome to Optimistic Web, where we explore the world of CSS and front-end development, one step at a time. Let's start with the first one. We have this empty element in our HTML. And with some basic styles, including background, outline, left and right margins, and fixed dimensions of 300 by 300 pixels, this is how it appears in the browser. Now suppose we want these dimensions to be flexible while still maintaining a perfect ratio between width and height. In the past, we relied on using fixed sizes or creative hacks like the vertical padding percentage technique. To create a perfect square, we would set the height to 0 and padding top to 100%. Similarly, typical media ratios like 4x3 and 16x9 could be achieved with padding top 75% and 56.25%, respectively. But the aspect ratio property in CSS doesn't require any of these hacks. It lets us define the desired width-to-height ratio of an element's box. This ensures that even if the parent container or viewport size changes, the browser will automatically adjust the dimensions to maintain the preferred ratio. All we need to do is set either the width or the height, or even none, and CSS will handle the rest. However, if both width and height are explicitly defined, the aspect ratio property will be ignored. And if the height is omitted, it defaults to 1. For example, a perfect square can be achieved with an aspect ratio of 1, while an aspect ratio of 16x9 creates that cinematic feel, keeping the element perfectly framed regardless of screen size. Similarly, an aspect ratio of 2x1 means the width will always be twice the height. As I mentioned, if the height is omitted, it defaults to 1. So in this case, if the width is 300 pixels, the height will be set to 100 pixels. Now let's take it a step further by adding an image to the card. Since the image has a different aspect ratio than the parent container, it leaves some empty space at the bottom. To make the image fill the entire box, we can set either its width or height to 100% and then apply the same aspect ratio we used earlier for the parent container. While this approach seems to work, the image looks distorted because its original aspect ratio differs from the rendered dimensions. To fix this, we can use the ObjectFit CSS property. The ObjectFit defines how an element's content responds to the width and height of its content box. In other words, it allows us to control how the content of replaced elements, like images or videos, should be resized to fit their container. This property accepts one of the 5 values: contain, cover, fill, none, and scale down. In most cases, it will either need the contain or cover. Using contain, the element is scaled to maintain its original aspect ratio while fitting within the content box. Like in this case, the image adjusts to fit the box but still respects its natural aspect ratio. And with cover, the element is scaled to maintain its aspect ratio while filling the entire content box. If the aspect ratio of the element doesn't match that of the box, the content will be clipped to fit. In our example, the image fills the entire box, covering it from top to bottom and left to right, while still preserving its natural aspect ratio. Now suppose we need an image overlay, similar to those commonly seen in hover effects. We can either add a separate HTML element or use a pseudo element to mimic the effect. Let's go with the after pseudo element for this project. Obviously, the first thing it will need is the gradient background. And to make it visible on top of the image, we will set its position to absolute along with the offsets. Also, the parent element must have a relative position. Otherwise, the overlay will cover the entire viewport. We can also adjust its opacity to keep the image visible underneath. Now, instead of individually setting the top, right, bottom, and left properties, we can use the inset property as a shorthand to combine all four into a single declaration. It accepts up to four values representing each side of the element. Similar to padding and margin, these values follow a clockwise direction. If only one value is declared, it applies uniformly to all four sides. When two values are provided, the first one sets the positioning for the top and bottom, while the second applies to the left and right. In the case of three values, the second one is repeated for the missing fourth side. Just like the four individual offset properties, it doesn't impact non-positioned elements. Moving on to the fourth property, we have used opacity for the image overlay, which appears okay, but it doesn't create the perfect look. In this particular case, opacity doesn't elevate the design as much as I would like. What we can do is replace the opacity with the Mix Blend mode. The Mix Blend mode allows us to seamlessly blend an element's content with its background and the content of its parent. This opens up a world of creative possibilities, including color mixing, knockout text, and transparent overlays. It offers a range of blending modes, such as overlay, difference, color, darken, multiply, soft light, hard light, and more. I think the color mode looks pretty good for this example. Feel free to check out this detailed video showcasing how to create knockout text effects using Mix Blend mode. Before we move further, let's add a call to action to the card. We'll use an anchor tag that can either take the user to a profile page or open a modal window. The CSS here will be straightforward, mainly focusing on typography and its hover effect. The main thing is its position. It will also use absolute positioning, but instead of applying individual offsets, we will utilize the inset property to align it with the bottom right corner of the outline. Now let's talk about logical properties. Logical properties in CSS offer a smart way to create flexible and maintainable layouts that can adapt to various languages and writing directions. In traditional CSS, we often specify physical dimensions and directions, such as width, height, margin top, margin bottom, padding left, and padding right. These physical properties make sense primarily when working in a horizontal and top-to-bottom direction. However, logical properties provide a more flexible approach by styling web elements based on their logical orientation, rather than depending solely on physical directionality. In logical terms, the vertical axis is called the block axis, while the horizontal axis is known as the inline axis. This means that the top and bottom directions can use the block keyword, while the left and right directions can use the inline keyword. For instance, instead of using margin left and margin right, we can use margin inline start and margin inline end. Similarly, the width can be defined as inline size, and the height becomes block size. This same approach applies to other properties as well. Next, here we are using the inset property for all four sides of the anchor tag, but only the right and bottom sides are defined. While there is nothing wrong with this CSS rule, it can be split into two separate properties. The inset inline end will set the right offset, while the inset block end will set the bottom offset. If you want to learn more about logical properties in CSS, feel free to check out this detailed video. As I mentioned earlier, these CSS properties might seem simple, but they're some of the most powerful tools for making CSS workflows smoother and more efficient. Let me know which one is your favorite in the comments below. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.